Hello, and welcome to the gameplay cast review for the third-person shooter, Helldivers 2. Helldivers 2 was developed by Arrowhead Game Studios and published by Sony. And unlike Helldivers 1, which was a top-down arcade-style shooter, Helldivers 2 is a third-person shooter. The game clearly takes a lot of inspiration from the Starship Troopers movie, and that can only be a good thing, because the first Starship Troopers movie was fantastic. We won't talk about the other three. Anyway, this game has become a viral success story, and a bandwagon I'm happy to jump on. Given the current size of my channel and the way the algorithm seems to work, I can't see that this review will do much view-wise.
Damn it, Jim, what the hell's the matter with you?
It's my channel, and she can take it. And I've told you, it's Tim, not Jim. So give me all she can give.
I'm giving her all she's got, Captain!
Good man. Anyway, it's a rare thing to see a game come from nowhere and receive unanimous praise. It feels equally rare for me personally that I get the bug these days. The bug being that feeling where all you want to do is pick up a controller, and in this case, spread democracy. For this reason alone, I feel it's my duty to Super Earth to do a review. So, is it hype? Or is it really as good as people say? It is as good as people are saying. Helldivers 2 gets a big fat seal of approval from this channel. To decide if you should dive into hell or not, continue watching to hear my justification, as well as the final score out of 10.
Come on, you ape! You wanna live forever!
Gamers can definitely be forgiven for hearing the words live service game and feeling a certain all-encompassing sense of anger, fear, and despair. A feeling that's totally justified. Warning, rant incoming. Many of us will have fallen victim to this curse with such titles as Destiny, Anthem, Marvel Avengers, and most recently, Suicide Squad Kills the Justice League. Being a BioWare fan, I really bought into Anthem and tried to force myself into liking it. I put on my thickest rose-tinted glasses and tried to enjoy the nonsensical story of the campaign, its grinding sections designed to pad the game out and waste my time, the frequently broken game mechanics and glitches, added great variety and unpredictability to the game too. Oh, and this really great base of operations with its ear cancer, music, ensured that after I lied to my friends to get them to play the game with me, the hangover was brutal. Suffice to say, I'll probably never play another BioWare game again. Honestly, you are kidding yourself if you think the next Dragon Age will be anything but a steaming dumpster fire. What's the point of this rant? Well, I'm getting there. The point is, that too many companies and developers look at games like Fortnite, see the live service model, and think, I'm gonna make all the money. They release their game, and it inevitably flops. They act all surprised, blame fans, piss and moan, etc. The point is, the game still needs to be good. Your core mechanics have to be satisfying. Live service games can 100% work, but the game still has to be good. At the same time, the experience needs to make players feel like they're part of a fair ecosystem, not simply a money pinata. The recent Suicide Squad game epitomizes how these big, supposed AAA developers go about their work. No focus on a satisfying story, gameplay, or even value for money for customers. Just get them in, charge them £70, and beat them to make them pay for more content and loot. Helldivers 2 is a live service game, and it absolutely shames these titles. It costs less than £40, you aren't made to gag on its in-game purchases like you're being choked by a huge black dildo, and best of all, it's a good game. It's tipped to have sold around 5 million copies in just over a month, and it's rumoured, or there's pressure groups trying to get it released on Xbox so the player base could expand even further. Compare this to Suicide Squad's pitiful 1300 user peak. Warner Bros. Haven't released the sales figures yet, but they don't have to. It's obvious this game has not sold well, and probably cost two, maybe three times more than Helldivers 2, and that's not including marketing, of which Helldivers 2 hasn't needed any from what I can see. Just for clarity, at 2 PM UK time on a Friday, there are 99,000 people currently playing Helldivers 2. Rant over, the prosecution rests. Getting back to the review, the fast-paced action of the main gameplay loop makes Helldivers 2 instantly satisfying, not to mention addictive. As with any game with aspirations of being good, the core gameplay mechanics need to be on point, and these definitely are. There's an absolute minimum of a tutorial, Then you're packed off on your ship and hell-potting your way onto an alien world to spread democracy. On the face of it, I'm tempted to classify this game as Fortnite for men, and as a member of that group, I can testify that the over-the-top heroism and Starship Troopers vibe really hits the spot. That said, any avid gamer should be able to enjoy this title. It is obviously repetitive. I'll go into the negative details in the what I didn't like section, but the developer has put a lot of effort to ensure no two missions will be exactly the same. There are two main enemies at the moment, the bug-like Terminids and the Terminator-style automatons. These are great and both distinctly different, with their own set of strengths, weaknesses, and tactics. You can also see from the way the main game map is configured that there's already space for at least two more enemy factions. Personally, I'd love to see some Warhammer 40k style space orcs, and or maybe something based on the xenomorph from Alien, but maybe that's a tad too close to the bugs we already have. There's a scattering of main and optional objectives on each mission. The ICBM one is a personal favourite. I love the effects and the animation. These are a tad samey, and after 5 to 10 missions you could have easily done them all. However, when combined with the different planet environments, weapons, support options and teammates, it really doesn't get old fast. The game is one of those rare pick up and play games. You can play a round or two on your lunch break, not saying I've done this by the way, scratch the itch and then put the controller down. It's pretty much seamless in how you can join up with friends, and the matchmaking is getting better by the day. By far one of the places the game shines most is the attention to detail. It feels like a labour of love from Arrowhead. Every screen, every environment, every objective has little details that show the developer's dedication and finesse. There's humorous reviews on the shopping page which make you smile whenever you're claiming new items. Planets with no atmosphere have meteor showers. Let's rephrase that to deadly meteor showers. The angle of attack changes for orbital strikes based on your position on the map. Even the emotes are interactive and fun. Hooking it out with a random stranger on the internet never gets old. I know I've banged on about the setting, but it is awesome when combined with the sound and humour. I never get tired of the little sequence when you jump into your hellpod and get fired down to the surface, or the inspirational speeches about democracy. It's just pure, unadulterated fun. Remember what it was like when people could literally do pretty much anything in a video game and no one cared? I mean, it seems like forever ago at this point, but there was a time when people actually used to seriously read Porygon and Kotaku, you know, for actual gaming journalism.
No way. No way.
Yes way, Bill and Ted. And games were games. This is pure old-fashioned video gaming at its best. God, I miss this stuff. Simple, addictive, escapism, fun. Not grey woke sludge. RIP Rocksteady. And while I'm at it, RIP AAA games. At this point, the industry is better off without the sludge pipe we get from the traditional AAAs. The best games are nearly always coming from new or small developers these days. And note the word, pure. It's not a political message, there's no underwritten extremist agenda. It's called fun. Deal with it. Beware anyone and anything that tells you otherwise.
It is a gift.
Honestly, I think there are only two to three main concerns when it comes to this game. The first, and by far the most obvious, is the servers and the glitches. I mean, I'm not super offended here, but there are some pretty crazy glitches. Like, just today I had a glitch where my grenades turned into question marks, and when I threw them, they didn't explode. Kinda weird, but yeah, there's some work to be done keeping things stable, particularly after updates. That said, I'm really willing to give them some leeway here, as a month into the game's release, we have weekly missions and objectives, they just added mech suits. These guys are pushing and doing the right things. Yes, early days the servers were not up to the task, but honestly, even that can be forgiven when you consider how viral this game's gone. I honestly think that the developer at this point is at 10 times their projected player base. The second is the repetitive nature of the gameplay loop. Don't get me wrong, I think there's a lot of positive factors in the gameplay that offsets this, as I mentioned previously, but ultimately there's no way to get around the repetitiveness. So while it's new and shiny and the game's full of players, it's all good. But live service games need content and updates to keep players coming back. If nothing was added, would the game still be as popular in 6 months' time? Probably not. Do I think this is likely? No, I think Arrowhead love their game and have got some pretty long-term plans to support it. The final thing I want to add as a kind of two-in-one complaint is the lack of viable single-player support. Yeah, you can totally play the game solo, and yeah, it's gonna suck, but that's just it. Sometimes the matchmaking just doesn't seem to add people to your game. And it's always those games where the AI decides to be super aggressive and just smash you for the duration of the mission. These missions are really not much fun, and the SOS beacon really seems to do next to nothing on these occasions. Guess it's just a matchmaking thing, so hopefully it will improve in due course. I'm also wondering if we couldn't get some solo-based campaign-style content that would, of course, be best played in a group, but could also be done solo, without the fear of the AI mercilessly murdering you. You can, of course, drop the difficulty and play on easier settings, but this limits the rewards offered. As you should be able to tell, I am a fan of this game. It ticks most of my boxes, and I don't regret buying it on Steam for a second. I don't know anyone who enjoys Starship Troopers and plays video games who wouldn't instantly love this game. The industry needs to sit up and take notes. This right here is how you make a live service game. Yes, it's early days, but look at this thing. Look at the details, the areas on the ship, and the game map that are purposely left for future content. Arrowhead has plans to support this game long term, and they put their heart and soul into this thing. Yeah, I'm over-egging it, but these days, most mainstream games are so great and uninspired, it's an event when you get something like this breakthrough. That said, am I really over-egging this? It's addictive, escapist fun. And I think I can honestly see a world where maybe I finally found that pick-up-and-play game I just keep coming back to for years to come. You know, like that game I used to play? Begins with H, ends in low. Yeah, Halo. How not to support a game. I think this game might have had more meaningful updates in a month than Halo Infinite has had in its entire lifetime. Wow, this review's kinda gone ranty, hasn't it? How would I score this game? Well, I think in its current condition, the game is a very respectable and solid 8 out of 10. And that's the verdict I'll stick with today. However, if they continue to add content, improve the servers, and fix the glitches, in 3 to 6 months' time, I think the game will be a 9 or even a 10 out of 10. So watch this space. Game of the Year 2024 is in Arrowhead's hands, in my opinion. And I'm quietly confident that they got this. I will be Helldiving for the foreseeable future, and I strongly encourage gamers to give the game a go. You won't regret it.
I'm doing my part.
Just before I sign off, I did mention this in the previous section, but do we think the game needs a campaign of sorts? Even if it was just a Titanfall-style campaign, I think this would make solo play a bit more consistent and fun. I mean, I do love a good campaign, so maybe that's just me. Let me know what you think in the comments below. And that is all you get. And as always, f*** Erebus. If you want to check out Helldivers 2 following this review, it's available on PlayStation and PC. This concludes the gameplay cast review for the third-person shooter, Helldivers 2.